tonight, so I'm happy to report that his wife is in labor. They're having their first child, and so I get to fill in for him, and I'm hoping that through the evening, I'll get a text and we'll know all the good details, and I'll share that with you. So I'm going to go over a few things before we go into our speaker this evening, so bear with me because I kind of got thrown under the bus here. And for those of you who were here when we had MNP, you'll know that the same sort of thing happened when MNP was here. One of their speakers, his wife was expecting, had the big scare. He had to bolt and they weren't prepared. So ever since then, I said to Jason, you make sure that at least there's some sort of notes or something that I can follow. So he did an awesome job. So I've got lots of paper. And I mean, I've been around long enough that I know all even more about the competition. So we wish him all the best, and we'll be sharing the great news after. So this is session 8. This is the final session, and it's called Putting It All Together. So I can tell you from my perspective of being the manager at Community Futures and hoping we get some really good business plans, that I hope all of you are well on your way on your business plan, filling it out and having some, you know, something concrete. And I'm going to remind you too that Community Futures, whether you're here in our audience or if you're online and you work with another Community Futures office, we're there to help you on your business plan, help you through some of these things. The only thing I would ask is make an appointment first, because it's our year end right now, so on top of everything else, we're extremely busy, but we will definitely make time and fit you in with either Morley or Jason and give you some advice. And if there's any other speakers that have been here and you want to contact them, just let us know too, and we'll make sure that you have those connections. So the standard, I'm not going to go through housekeeping really. You've been here for 7 weeks, you know what the drill is. It's just pretty much the same old. Tonight we're going to have presentations by Bruce Thurston, and I'm going to make sure I have these names right, and Matt Kellen?
Pretty close, yeah.
Kellen.
You got it.
Kellen, okay. All right. So anybody who's actually ever heard Bruce talk, I've never heard Matt, so knows that you're in for an exciting evening. Bruce is, he's a genius when it comes to this sort of thing. He helps a lot of businesses. He's got a great background in business, and so he's going to do his own intro, because I would probably take a half an hour and just, I worship him, so it's good. Then after Bruce's presentation is finished, we're going to take another break, and then I'm going to go through making sure that you understand all of the criteria, the timelines, and making sure that I drill down over and over again what's expected of you to compete. I want to also let you know that the competition closes at 2 p.m. on April 21st, and there are no exceptions, so please, please, please get your business plans in early. The earlier you submit them to us, we will go through them, we'll make sure that there's no red flag, that it follows the process and it does everything else. If you come in at the last minute, like 10 other people are probably going to do, we're going to just take it, and then come 2 o'clock, if you don't meet the criteria, you're not going to be eligible. So be ahead of the game. If you do like that on almost anything, even in business, it's nice to have those things kind of out of the way, and then breathe easy. With that, I am going to basically turn it over to Bruce, and then the rest of the stuff, like I say, I'm going to go over at the very end. So John will come up and he will load Bruce's and Matt's presentation. And I'm just going to sit back there and I'm going to field the questions online. And do you entertain questions throughout, or do you can let them know how you prefer?
Sure, you bet. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I'm Bruce Thurston. This is my colleague, Matt Kellen. And we've had the pleasure of being in this room many times in the past, either as students or teaching. On Saturday, we were here doing a case competition for KPMG students. 4 teams competed, and Matt's team that he coached won, which was really cool. So had some very tough competition, and the topic was Rona, the lumber company, right? And it had gone down into a decline during 2008, 2009, and the case was, should we try a new tact coming out of the recession period? And it was very, very interesting. So Matt's gonna work with us today, and we're gonna use quite a bit of Excel. We'll have a short presentation, then we're gonna show you the power of the numbers, because running business, it's all about the numbers. Those who have a strong grasp do very, very well on it, guaranteed. I have 2 oil and gas service providers that I consult right now up north. Both of them are profitable. Both of them are financially solid in this time. And their competitors are bailing left, right, and center. They manage their numbers. None of them have accounting education, but they learned what the tools meant. And it's absolutely amazing to listen to these folks that are not trained in accounting speak about the numbers. So I will encourage you. This is a really neat book that you can get at Chapters, probably in the library is my guess too. Now it looks thick, but what's unique about it is it's all pictures. Now this is millennial stuff, right? Okay? Because nobody reads anymore. Okay? But it's all pictures that describe really cool stuff. So it's HR, it's organizational structure, it's finance, it's marketing, it's how things happen if you got a little organization with some inventory. Very, very visual. It's called How Business Works. Right? So go into Chapters, grab yourself a tea and coffee, pull the book, go sit on the bench by the window there and read it for free. Right? Go do that, you know? Have some fun. If it ever rains or if it ever snows, go do that. Because as an entrepreneur, you've got to be a sponge. And you pick things up and you build a network. And that success of your network drives your success in the organizations. So I was one of two owners of a company called Charlton Hill. I sold my interests in 2003. 27 days later, I had a massive heart attack. The lawyer signing the deal off to my ex-partner said, "Hey, lucky you're not 55, because guys like you, triple type A personalities, usually die 30 days later." Shucks, I was trying to beat that record at 27, right? But fortunately, there was a nurse in the lobby in a hotel up in Edmonton that saw what was happening and gave me aspirin. You see the commercials? Heart attack coming on, take an aspirin type thing? She said, "Chew on this, buddy," after I woke up. And I was rushed in. I had a triple bypass. So every day I get to look at the scars of my life and think about what an idiot I was, because I didn't balance life. And so I'm telling you, get into business, but enjoy it so much that you balance it. But I forgot my kids' names. I was so driven. It was crazy what I did. Okay, so I am the idiot. I don't want you to be. Balance your life and work on that, you know. So since then, I've tried to. Now, the good part that's come out is, back then I damaged the wall of my heart. And they said, for life. And then I found out this summer, no. Stem cells can regenerate. And I discovered on July 8th that I have a normal heart again, right? So I've been given a second chance. And as my wife and daughters would say, don't mess it up. Right? So very, very cool. So you never know. Don't assume anything. So we'll start off with a couple broad slides here that have some messages in them, and then we'll go down a little bit. So here's the agenda. We'll talk about these particular areas, because I was in two of your sessions and I had the pleasure of doing some of this a couple years ago, and I got to hear your speakers, and so I want to make sure that a few points get driven home. So we'll talk about this and many others, I'm sure. This is a map, and this is a local producer. This is Green Prairie, and there are two guys, that farm boys, that had a crazy idea of shipping Timothy Hay to Japan, Korea, and China. And their formal education is minimal. But they had a dream and they had a desire. And they said, and the Japanese love Timothy Hay. They feed it to our cattle. We don't in North America. So they buy the hay, let's say 145 Canadian. You know, I don't know what the prices are this day. And the farmer's got some big responsibilities. You can see it. And then they're the processors, so they have to get the supply, they have to get the contract set up, they have to make sure that the product's worthy and they're working those fields with the guys. They have to market and sell that product, and believe it or not, guys from Japan come here in August and September, and they hang out in Green Prairie's operation. There's a room in there that have all kinds of plastic storage bins that have samples, lots of samples, of Timothy Hay. And these guys fly all the ways in from little Japan, 120 million people, right? And they sniff and scratch and chew. Hey, amazing, right? They look at the color, they look at everything. You know? these guys have turned their idea into a global phenomenon. They have hay that goes to United Arab Emirates. They've had, I like to call it alfalfa, head over to Europe. They've had all kinds of innovative ideas going on. Now, this particular one is, I put a map in the middle and say, well, we're in Alberta and they're shipping it across that much water? You know, absolutely mind-boggling. And then to give an idea of Japan in relationship to British Columbia, I put a little map there. But as you can see, the process that's got to go to transport these hay, right, 26 metric tons in a 40-foot container. And at the time I was working with them, they shipped 5,000 containers a year. 5,000 26 metric ton units of hay a year over there. The logistics were incredible. Squeezing hay was easy, hydraulics did it. But to be able to sell it to a farmer and in US dollars. So now do you think our exporters are making money these days? Darn rights. Liquid gold, I like to call it. So if these guys aren't, and I haven't talked to them for a long time, something's definitely wrong. But that's the advantage, and that's what we're going to be trying to have with a low dollar. Now, if you go down to Great Falls and you want to buy, you're upset. But if we can market our product internationally, we got to win. So what I put this up here for is two guys had an idea and became international. Both strong Dutch Reform guys. I like working with them because my wife says, you don't have to work on Sundays. Matter of fact, if you did, you'd get fired, right? Okay. So it's really, really good. Had never been outside of Southern Alberta. And you get John Van Heerden, who's about yay high, you know, big, burly guy. And imagine him in Tokyo in a subway. Imagine him crossing a street that has a million people crossing it in one day. Traffic, pedestrian traffic at an intersection. Unbelievable. Now there's a spirit. There's something in the gut that drives. So what I'm trying to give you as an overview here is, do you have that? Because if you do, you can take the world as they did. Okay? So that kind of idea. Let's take a look at another one. This is hard to read. This is a mind map. And I did it for the owners of Kicking Horse Coffee in BC a couple years ago. And they're very, very creative people. They're not linear. They're not logic sequential. They're creative folks. And this mind map that I developed for them, and I will give you a copy if you want, okay, on a PDF. It's just a little bit bigger than what it imagines. It looks at all the things to consider when you're starting up a small business. He says, Bruce, I need something. So when I get a business idea, I can put it up on the wall, and I can see what have I considered and what have I missed. So I spent a weekend, one fine summer, out in my backyard, building this for him on Visio, and he's used it in the past. Now, what's most important is something up in the top corner that says, who am I? Because in any business, you've got to know who you are and what are you looking for. And I run into too many people who want to get into business because they're tired of working for the man. I'm sick of the man, and I want what he's got. And one of the classics I look at is Osho Restaurant. Osho started on 5th Street in a very, very small place, moved to 3rd Avenue, and then moved to Courthouse. And two of the guys that work there, there's a Lexus and there's a Mercedes parked out front. Well, I'll tell you, if you tried to build a business for 30 to 40 years and you're rolling sushi, you better drive there in style, because it ain't no fun. You know, you've got to love the art and the artistry of it. So, you know, you got to put things in context. A lot of people I run into think they're going to make money instantly, and I have yet to see many that make money the first year. Many. So unless it's a unique thing, usually you don't make money the first year. If you're not making money by the third year, your relatives are going to be unhappy. You've got to look at it, and it's all about having that market in the process. So that's the idea with that. Just a couple more basic ones. Professional service firms, I do quite a bit of work for folks, and there's nothing more pleasurable than getting a check from a lawyer. Giving checks to the lawyers. Wonderful people, brilliantly trained people, okay? But they or medical people or any, and you may very well be in the service sector yourself, very, very simple. You're gonna be have a fee capacity. The market demands so much of you, and you won't get it all. You'll be able to have so many in sales revenue yourself. And then you've got your direct costs, which will be you and some other services that you provide to the folks. And you'll have a bunch of overhead. And then you'll end up with some costs from bank, borrowing, financing, things like that. And then Trudeau didn't drop your small business tax more than what he was promising, so people are upset. Personally, I still think 10-11% tax is pretty darn low for small businesses, but that's just my bias. And then you've got something left over. So the idea is you start big with some dollars and then you end up with not too much. Some people say, I'm gonna make a ton of money. So I thought for the purpose of this exercise today, we'd take a look at what a ton of money is. And let me just go down. I thought I had, oh, it's on spreadsheet. Yeah, yeah, that'd be dandy. You wanna see a wizard on Excel, you're gonna see one with Matt tonight.
I don't know how to get out.
Do we know how to flip? Is it a toggle?
Escape. I did try that first. Let's just see.
That was a separate file, right?
Yeah. So what we'd have to do is stop sharing.
So I'll tell you what, for the time being, let's continue with this, and then we'll go over to the spreadsheet. So when you're working with people and stuff like that, here's some key components when things can go wrong. And frequently, when there's more than just one person involved, things will go wrong. You're not clear with your partners on things. You don't have things in writing. Things will go wrong. They mentioned to you a unanimous shareholder agreement. USAs are very, very important because life changes with people. My buddy Kerry Seibel from AirTech, he was president of AirTech. Next day at 43, he has a stroke. Nothing wrong with the guy. The only negative he had was he didn't eat enough vegetables. But he was a normal kind of guy. Thin, the whole bit, didn't have symptoms of being stroke or heart attack candidate. And it turned his life upside down. They had a USA agreement that had seven people, seven partners involved. The USA saved everybody the tough decisions of what do you do when your president has a stroke and can never come back to work again. All right? Stuff can happen to you. I say 30% of you will have a short-term disability between the age of 30 and 60. You've got to make sure you're protecting yourself and your family in that regard. I had my heart attack. I had disability insurance. Huh? I was thinking ahead in the process, and that helped the game. He had disability insurance set up to be tax-free. He lives off of that now, having had his stroke. Okay? Tax-free, because he didn't claim it as an expense for tax purposes. So he's been able to live off of that. It has a cost of living index built into it. Okay? Just talking numbers, I started work in 1979 and my dad retired working as a civil servant at $16,000 a year. I started working at $16,000 a year. He lived for 26 years and he had an indexed pension plan. And when he passed away, the indexed pension plan was paying him $45,000 a year. My mother lived another 10 years on half of that pension, and she was getting $30,000 a year. 60 would have been the total, okay? You have to think that the costs of living over those particular examples, things go up, and you need to build and put something away for the future, always. Out of sight, out of mind, you know, a wealthy barber says, pay yourself first, do that in your business. Put something away so that you've covered yourself, otherwise you'll run into troubles. Like we're having here.
Yeah.
So on the screen that we'll show you again is some of the management issues. So cash, everyone has said it, is king. And that's why you've got to really manage it well. I went to one place, I was in the fancy office. I opened a drawer and the president of the company, I opened his wallet. It was a brown wallet. I brought it with me today and it was empty. And I said, whose is this? He says, it's mine. Nothing in it. He says, yeah, I know, that's why you're here. I say, if you don't know where the money is in your small business right from the get-go, get in line so you can manage the operation from there, okay? Are we lucky? Oh, cool. So, people say, oh, I'm going to make 50% bottom line. I'm going to make 30% bottom line. Well, I went to SageWorks and I went to the NAC codes and I pulled off this information. It's probably 2014 information. And it gives you an idea of the type of industries and the net profit margin for small business and their profitability. Accountants, imagine that, 20% at the top, right? Oil, gas extraction, imagine that, 19.2. Legal services, 16.5% bottom line. So that's bottom before tax. That's sales minus all the costs give you that. So on $100, if the accountant's done it right, he's paid all his expenses, paid himself a wage, he's got 20 bucks left over if he's done it right. That's really good. Most companies that I see are nowhere close to that. Okay? The average plumber in the United States is $3.30. Now some are as high as 14, and some are negative 10. They're losing money like crazy because they're not managing their dollars. So that's the kind of perspective that we've got. So I put some of this here, and I added a couple others that were in on this side because they came from two sources. So you never want to say these are gospel at all, but they're good indicators for you to give you an idea. So at the end of the day, how much are you going to make? Brown Street Cafe, classic example. No alcohol served in that business. Bonnie Greenshields worked hard to build her business. That type of industry is $4.40. Earl's on food product, it's $6.60. So for every $100 worth of food sold, at the end, $6.60 is what they've got left over after they paid everything, okay? And then you gotta take tax off of it. So, of course, it's volumes. I just did a grocery store analysis. Small grocery stores are dying like crazy right now. The independents don't survive. The big boys are taking them over. 2%, if they're doing it well. $2 of every 100, they must do volume to survive in the process. So you can find this out. I have no secrets. I use Google. And I go and say restaurant margins. And it's absolutely amazing what they tell you. You know, the information is there. Sometimes there's some fancy reports, but the information is there. Now, can we switch back or is that dangerous?
Oh.
Oh. Are we lucky or not? Okay. So we won't worry about that.
So we want to go back to the
PowerPoint, if you've got it. And then shortly thereafter, I'll ask you to go back one more time. And then we won't bother you anymore, John. John is a genius, okay? Now, Darlene said I was a genius. I'm not a genius. My grade 9 math teacher told me I was a genii. And he says, you know what a genii is? Your solution to that math problem, I couldn't understand it. You must be a genii. You fail. Right? That was great stuff.
I'm just gonna drag that.
So what we find is that people have big dreams. When we look at your plans that you're submitting, I like to look at three scenarios. Best case, most likely case, and worst case scenario. In recessionary times, businesses look at things different than in growth times. There's two different things to consider. So recessionary times, maintaining cash is key. And not extending credit is most important. On growth times, extending credit is much more allowable because banks will do it. Oil and gas, we had two factors. I redid a business plan for some guys the previous summer were trying to sell their business to some investors in Texas. And they loved the stuff. They didn't do a deal. And then the market started to drop. We redid the business plan so that he could buy some of the dumb iron that's out there that's cheap. And that and the banks we went to looked at us and said two things. You're in the oil and gas sector. And you're in Alberta. and you just had a change in government, we don't think we're lending you a red nickel. So those factors will impact you. So you may have a dream, but the other stakeholders may very well be telling you a different story. So under the management side here, so for your service firm, low cash, declining revenues and margins, and we'll talk about that. Lack of timely action on negative metrics. So you sit with a banker, says, what are you doing about it? And you don't do anything about it. Potential legal exposure, contract liability. So the lawyer was here, Stephen. And I say, he who has the last piece of paper wins. Do not do it this way with people. Get the signatures, most important. Get the documents. A USA, unanimous shareholder agreement, is a document between partners in an organization. You got it laid out in any event, what the conditions are. So make sure you get it in writing. That's why you get purchase orders. You get contract documents signed. Because at the end of the day, the judge is going to look at the facts if it gets that far. If it doesn't, 95% don't, you're negotiating. And the trick is, in the legal system, when you're owed something, the problem is that the time in the legal system can really cause problems for you. Because it's so blocked up, it's their world, it's not your world. So I had a lawsuit against me. It took 4 years to resolve. 10,000 pieces of paper I produced for in my defense. I thought I had insurance. I didn't have insurance. A number of factors came into play. It consumed 6 months of my life and probably was attributed to one of my 9 blockages. It's my guess. Didn't make me any money. Don't get into those situations. Get it in writing all the time and you'll save yourself. So poor unstable relationship with the banks. Never ever upset the banker. Darlene's a banker. Always do what you say you're going to do. If they need reports in a timely fashion, you give them reports in a timely fashion. It's such a simple thing, but people get sloppy. And the Community Futures has some very good avenues for banking, better than the other banks, because they realize that it's a more riskier venture to take on, and they're helping people out who are starting. Most banks won't take you. You don't have a track record. The big banks are not into the small businesses. Okay? So it'll be a while before you can get that potential financing. Am I correct on that?
Yeah.
You betcha. So unwillingness to cut back when demand flattens. Still want to buy. So one of the interesting organizations that I tracked was Intrigue, a lingerie place. And they found an idea on Oprah, opened a store. And I asked the owners, I said, so tell me, if there was something I could tell people starting off, what would it be? And so they have different sizes for women's lingerie. Okay? And when they went out and bought everything, all the different sizes that they have, they went out and bought a whole bunch of stuff. It doesn't work that way. If they had talked to a few fine folks, they would have found there's some kind of normal distribution with people when it comes to sizes. And so, as they said, my husband keeps reminding me every year when we do inventory count in the basement that we've still got all this stuff here and we've still got all this stuff here. And we can't get rid of it because people aren't there. So getting to know inventory sizes, really, really important. Understand what the market wants for you, okay? So, down we go. Oh, cool. A dear friend from Bozeman gave me this, and we'll send you the slides so you can read a little bit better. But in order to build opportunity, what you need to have, and I can barely read it myself here, so I'll look on this screen here. The red is a vision. The blue is skills. The green is incentive, don't want to do it. The orange is resources. And the yellow is an action plan, your business plan. You need all of those to effectively build your business. Without one of them, you get what Matt and I get to see in a number of businesses on a regular basis. They're missing a key component. So this is a nice general idea of the things to cover. And you'll have access to these, right? So you'll be able to see it better than what this is particular producing in the process. This was a real humbling moment when I was running the company. We were missing a number of key components here. And it explained a lot as to why we had a lot of confusion, anxiety, and nobody really wanted to change in the organization. So when we grasped that idea, we made some significant changes. So know your numbers. And for those of you who aren't into numbers, find somebody who is. And get a feel. Just find somebody who can help you out in the process. And it sounds like Morley and Jason and Darlene's operations there to give you some good indications. So can we flip now over?
Bruce was talking about the margins in different industries there. I haven't been in the workforce that long. I think it's been 4 or 5 years now. But I have been really fortunate to be on one spectrum of really, really, really low margins, and now I'm in a higher margin business. And it's funny because you learn really quick that you want to get in the business with the high margin. So I started out, I did my first 3 years in manufacturing. Manufacturing is, it kind of destroys your soul a little bit, actually. Because like he talks about, you start with that $100, and we would fight and scrimp and scrounge and save money, and we'd end up with $3 or $4 left over from that $100, and it is so frustrating. And not only that, the worst part is that we never had any cash. Even if I said we made money, never had any cash, because everything was tied up in inventory. And we'll go through those numbers. But when we talk about the cash and the money making, that's the important thing to understand, is that just because you're making money doesn't mean you have cash, and vice versa. You could be losing money and have lots of cash on you. And in fact, that's often what happens, and we'll go through some of that, is in the times where you're making all this money, you don't have anything. And then in the times where you're not making as much money, you have tons of cash.
So John, can we convert now to the spreadsheet and we'll never bother you again?
Yeah.
Okay.
The 28 days, I never had to borrow again because we got tight on the cash. And don't feel that you should be generous on allowing people credit. You've done hard work, you've done a value to them, they've received the value. Don't let the dollar be the stigma from you being able to progress. That's how business go broad. Okay, so this is a true example of a company. Happens to be a plumbing company, because I mentioned their margins are so low. If we look at the top, over this 5-year period, the guy started off as a one-man shop at $250,000 in sales, plumber. Right now in town, you can get a plumber for $89 an hour and up, okay? They buy their stuff from a wholesaler at $50, and they'll charge you $100 for it, 100% markup. That's the norm, okay? You find these things out by checking out those industries in the process. So what happened to him is he did not, in his operating expenses, pay himself a wage. So this net profit thing at the bottom, you know, if he collected on anybody, he was paying a wage out of that. We say, don't do that. Build your wage into that operating expense. Because when people say, I'm gonna get paid out of profit, you heard Morley say that the other day, garbage, okay? You've gotta be paying yourself a regular basis or you're giving your work away. So look at what happened to him. He went to 700,000, 1.8 million, 3.2 million, and he went to $5 million. And look at his bottom line. So a lot of people go and say, if I can grow my sales, I'll make a lot of money. This guy did not make any money. Tragic. And this it happens more times than you can possibly think. Now, did you have a question?
Question. Yeah, you're saying you make sure that you incorporate your own pay into it.
Yeah.
How do you figure out what a good pay is that's not overzealous or undercutting your own abilities?
Well, what I would do is I'd look, what would a person, a plumber like him, make on a regular basis working for somebody else? Okay? What would he make? Now, I believe plumbers make about $32.50 in town right now. Some of the higher end ones, depending, are you residential, commercial, or industrial? But $32.50 would be probably about the going rate in the process. So then anything over that, okay, billed as profit. Okay? Now you gotta remember, a lot of these plumbers have benefit plans, pension plans, that kind of stuff. So it's that payroll burden or that additional stuff you want to consider as well as the benefits to make sure that you're paying into Blue Cross or the chamber has a number of plans very economical that can help you in that kind of stuff. So looking around, talking to some of these fine folks, they'll tell you where some of the hot deals are in order to protect yourself in the process.
So there's really good resources as well to look at what you should be paying based on different industries. I think PayScale is kind of the top one. That's what, whenever I'm doing a recruiting for a position, I always go there first, because it'll tell you for Canada, it'll tell you for your province, it'll tell you for your community, so Southern Alberta. So there's lots of good resources like that, but PayScale is really good at saying this is what this type of person should be making.
So you put your business plan together and you're only paying yourself $10 an hour? People laugh at your business plan because you haven't been realistic, okay? And maybe the truth hurts. Maybe the market isn't there for your plan to begin with and you're just trying to make the numbers juggle, you know? We take a look at it. When I've been a judge, I'll go into your industry and I'll look at the comparatives and see where you're at. See if you've given us a real story or one of those airy fairy dream stories, right? Because there's money involved in this, it's serious. I'll spend several hours looking at a particular presentation. We'll analyze it quite closely, because we can tell if it's come from BP online or not, right? I mean, they make them look pretty, but are they realistic in the process? So this was classic example. Move over profit margins now. Now, so that was what I showed you. So if you think you're making 30, 40, 50%, tell me what business and I might invest in it. Matt will too. After we've done our due diligence, okay? But chances are, you're not gonna make a lot of money on the bottom line. If you are, hats off to you, you're good for you. But I'd like to make sure you see it correctly through everyone's eyes. So don't be afraid to have the skeptics give you a review. We'll move over market share now. So here's a classic, and I just wanna use the document here is, I had a client, that said, I'm going to make a lot of money selling something out in the marketplace for $50. I have to pay $40 for this item that I'm going to sell out in the marketplace. And I'm going to sell it locally in the process. So I said, well, this is interesting. They put a business plan together. They were at ExecuServe. And I said to this person, what do you want for desired income? And they said, well, $40,000 would be nice. So if you take a look at the math here, they have a what we call a contribution margin $10. They're having to pay somebody $40. They're being able to charge $50, and hopefully they collect on it all. And they got a desired income. So this has got no other costs attached, which is ridiculous. Okay, they need to do 4,000 units. Okay? Sad part was, there is no demand for 4,000 units in Southern Alberta. There's no demand for 4,000 units in Calgary, Alberta. But they want it to be in Lethbridge. And this market only has about 185,000 people serving market. And this particular product, not everybody was buying it. It was for a select group. Now this person, I give them credit because they went out and asked if there was an interest in the product. But where they messed up was the volume. They just were believing that they could sell this and they couldn't sell it, guaranteed. So I got a free lunch because I put a bet with them on it, right? So over here, I want to show you the power of selling price. So you see the 4,000 units required. If we just change that to $60, all of a sudden, and at $40 is fixed, it's not variable, because that's what they pay for each one of these transactions from their supplier, all of a sudden they just have to sell 2,000. Now will the market pay $60 in the process. Will they look at that? And they may. You've got to test the market to find out if the price is right. If we went $80, so they're actually getting some positive contribution there now. They've got 1,000 units to sell. Whole different story than 4,000. The effort to sell 4,000 of anything is a lot of work. A lot of work, you know? And so what I encourage people to do is look at the totals of your numbers and look at the unit costs of your numbers. Don't just look at one or the other. Don't think big time like you see on Dragon's Den. Get it down to reality. What does that mean, okay? And so often what I'll suggest to people is if they say they're going to do 20,000 units, I'll ask them to break it down per week and then per day. And then they get sort of an awakening because they can see a day, but they can't understand what the value of a year is. So coffee shops are a classic. How many drinks do they have to serve each hour in order to do volumes that they're looking for? Starbucks has got it broken down to a science. They can tell you at the Starbucks on Memorgoth Drive that between 8 and 8:30, the predominant people buying are women who are dropping their kids off at school and they need that drink. And they described to me what the drink was, some white something or other. I don't keep track of that, but they've got it broken down, you know? And all that kind of information goes into their computer and they keep records. If you go to Earl's and talk to Maria Daly, she's got this big manual book and she'll tell you what everyone ate 5 years back on this day. Got that information. She kept it manually. It wasn't in a computer. That blew me away, right? You know? She says, Bruce, I'll show you what I sold. And she's using that to judge what her food order should be every week. Payment to food services is 7 days. No 30, no 45. If you don't have a check for them when they bring the food the next time, you don't get the food. Those are smart people. They're making sure they're getting money from restaurants which have a high failure rate. Because people get into restaurants for the love, and then they run out of money. 4.4% is really bad. It's a lot of love and work. Now, Bonnie loved her to death, but she had to be up at 6 in the morning to put the muffins in the convection oven to be ready to be open at 7. That's the kind of work that hardworking people like that did. And she, you know, I used to send a lot of folks over and say, talk to her. And she'll give you an experience of what it has been like for her. So I encourage you, talk to other people out there. They'll tell you their stories, and you learn from those people. Okay, so let's see, do we have another one on here? Okay, another classic. Chinook Entrepreneurial Challenge, person put a business plan together. Okay, so I went, looked at the business plan, and I said, okay, the market size is 850 units in Lethbridge. Okay. Houses. New houses being built, 850. This person wanted to put a particular product in. And I researched and found out that that product is considered odd and only 2% of the households would consider that product in their house. So I go and say, out of 850 houses, at the best, they might be able to sell this product into 17 homes. What's the chance? Not much. And he hadn't done this basic research, hadn't looked at it, hadn't talked to home builders to see if they even thought the idea was good. Because what happens is in your little business plans, you get so caught up in front of your computer doing stuff, you don't talk to humans. You gotta go out and talk to humans and see what they're saying. Do they like the idea or don't they like the idea? That moves you along in the process. So that's the quick and dirty on market size. Service capacity. Let me just change one number here. Okay. You're a service provider out there. Let's take a look at you. You are one person. Huh? Let's say you want to pay yourself $60,000 a year. Your rate is $65 per half hour or $130 per hour for the service you're providing. Huh? I never thought of it, but it. My wife goes to somebody who does nails and toes and all that kind of stuff, you know. 15 years ago, it was rare. Now it seems to be part and parcel of everybody's budget, right? You know, I'm going, wow, amazing. The one she goes to is booked a year in advance. She works out of her house. This is good stuff, you know? She had to hire somebody to phone people to remind them to come, but she's full tilt. Hats off to her, success story. Very cool. That's not what this person is, but I'm gonna show you the power of some of the numbers here. Has a facility with potential of 5 rooms, okay? So hours a day, wants to work 8 hours, wants to work 40 weeks per year, 12 weeks off, 40 weeks per year. Average capacity, let's assume it's 100%. Let's assume supplies are 1%, you can change it, I don't care. Rent, let's say they're paying $20 a square foot, got 2,000 square feet for 40,000. Let's say there's 2 admin people helping that particular person. Communications, 2,400, advertising, 12,000, and of course, professional services, 5,000. Now, there could be a whole bunch of other stuff there, but I'm just gonna show you the power of the numbers, most important. So part one, when we go and do this, and we have a service provider and they're at 100% capacity, on a per hour basis, 65 times two is $130. On a per day basis, working 8 hours, 1,040. On a per week, 5,200. On a per year, $208,000.
Wow.
The power of numbers, okay? Now, you can say a number of different things. Let's plug in 80% capacity, okay? Yeah, sorry. Can we?
There we go.
Well, awesome, okay? So 80% knocks it down to $166,400 as far as what was in. So now, I want to show you the revenues, 166.4, if we move down just a little bit, Matt. Okay, what's the bottom line in the process? So we've got contribution of 104,000, then you got your admin costs, your rent, your advertising, your communication, your accountant, and you're losing money, $34,000 lost. So it sounded like a big number, but you've got bills to pay because you've got those admin people in the process, okay? So now, let's kick it back up to 100%, and let's just scurry down and take a look what it looks like, Matt. Okay, there you're making a whopping $6,520, because you got some big fixed expenses there, okay? Now, in your model, you might not have anybody, but I'm just showing you this particular model. So we go back up, let's take a look and say, okay, the service that I provide, I can go in and I can work with someone for a while, they wait in their room, and I'll come back at the end and I'll go to another room in between. So if we do 2 rooms, we're now $416,000. And let's take a look at our bottom line. We're now 51% of sales. That's wonderful numbers. Just by rethinking how you can deliver the service. Okay, that's the power of the numbers. Now, in this particular scenario, what if we go to 5 rooms? $1,000,000. Fixed costs are there, $830,000. Okay, if you could be creative and actually do something like this, that's the power of the numbers. But if it's just you, you only got so many hours in the day. But if you can use yourself in different forms and fashions, fantastic. So, dentists do this. Number of seats get filled. Now this isn't a dental. They're not $65 for half an hour. Okay? And they've got some big expenses, dental assistants and staff and all that kind of stuff in the process, you know. But we give this to you as, if you're providing services, as a potential model to really make some bucks. And this is the power of using something as simple as Excel and some basic numbers to see what can this tell you. Okay. I guess we should move on. Eh? Any questions on this? You think it's any smoke and mirrors? Don't want it to be smoke and mirrors. Okay.
The only thing I would say in hesitation on that though is, like, that $1,000,000 in revenue there is great and the numbers make sense, but is the market there for it? Mm-hmm. Right, because that's the key. Cause go back to this last portion here. If this is the scenario over here, it doesn't matter what the figures show you. If you can't get a customer through your door to sit in that chair or whatever it is, you're not going to reach that million.
Yeah.
So that's great. Make your numbers work. Be creative. Find a way to increase what you can bill out per hour. But the numbers have to work. The market has to say that it's okay.
The fitness world, where you've got all these fitness instructors, most of them aren't making much money, okay? Find a niche and specialize in that niche, you can make money. But 99% of the fitness instructors won't be focused enough to service a particular niche. So if you can find that niche and focus on people who have money, and what are they looking for? Maybe one-on-one, maybe flexibility on time, maybe a personalization relationship building rather than what you experience at some of these gyms. Okay? My daughter works at Good Life for the fun of it at nighttime, and it costs, she makes $25 an hour gross. But when I consider how many hours she puts into it and her certification requirements that she has to go up to Calgary and pay for accommodations and the fees and all that kind of stuff, she's doing it for the love at nighttime, not for the money. The love, right? But she saw me had a heart attack and she says, I'm going to be fit, Dad. I'm not going to be an idiot like you, right? Okay. So let's move to the next one, pricing. Okay. So this is the power of pricing. And we want to show you some combinations here as to how the product can look. So if we look at the first one here, remember I mentioned units, and then I said look at totals. Always important. So this number of units to sell, we're putting up 20,000. Selling price is $15. Our variable cost is $9 for it. We have $6 margin to help cover those fixed costs that we talk about. And I've just put in 70,000 as a number in this particular case. So if we ran the numbers of 20,000 there, we have a margin at the bottom, net profit or operating income profit, people use a number of different terms, of 50,000 in the process, okay? Now, the power, what I want to say, you can increase your volume. So Matt, I want to show part one. So here we increase the volume by 15%. So we go from 20 to 23,000 units, okay? The selling price, we keep the same, the variable costs stay the same, fixed costs stay the same. We literally go from $50,000 up to $68,000 on the bottom line by increasing 3,000 units. These guys will have these spreadsheets, won't they?
Yes.
You bet. So you'll be able to use them. So now we've got a pretty decent profit margin of 20% in the process. Okay. Now, the next one here, we want to show a few things here. Let's say we're going to increase our volume, and we're going to do it by dropping our price. So in this scenario, and these are all interactive, you can plug numbers all you want, 15% sales volume increase, so we stay at 23, but to get that, we're going to drop our price in the process. So we drop our price from $15 to $13.50, a 10% decrease. Look at what happens. All of a sudden, by getting that volume, but dropping our price, because we want that volume, it's all about volume, no it isn't, $33,500 is what you make, you're down to 11% by giving that away. You've got to be very careful when you drop your price to get something. Very, very careful. An example that we've often used in one of the sessions we teach is cleaning people, residential cleaning people. I'll go out and I'll ask, what's the range for cleaners? And I get $15, I get $20. I've had 25, I've had 30, I've had $50 an hour, and someone tried to tell me somebody charges $100 an hour in Lethbridge for cleaning a residential house. Okay, it ain't me, right? Okay. So I go and say, think about it for price. If there's this $30 person and a $20 person, and they're exactly the same on what they do and provide services, this $20 person is not doing justice to themselves. Because for every hour worked, this person gets 30, this person gets 20, this person is losing a potential of $10 not knowing what their value is in the marketplace. And multiply it out by 2,000 hours a year if she's or he's a hardworking individual, man, that's $20,000 that you're giving away because you don't think you've got the value. Don't do that to yourself. So when you go into the marketplace and say, I'm going to capture market share because I'm going to be the lowest, I question it. Because if you're going to take that tactic, someone else will take that tactic too. You're not new to that. Find out what your value is and be a value differentiator. Now, in this world, it's so easy to be in this world and do a good job. I've had a few fine cleaning people, but no one's ever given me a sheet of paper that says, this is what I'm doing on a weekly, two-weekly, monthly, quarterly, seasonal basis. And I'm going to charge you that, but when I come on a quarterly or seasonal basis and do those outside windows, I'm going to charge you more. And what I'm looking for is I'm looking for value, because I'm trying to get something that I don't have to do in the process. So remember, don't look at this as your top. Look at this as to what other values you can add in your business to generate money for yourself, because you're worth it. You're putting the effort in. Don't undercut yourself. That's the example of cleaning people out there. And it's all over the map. It's crazy. So we've got now another scenario here where we've dropped the sales volume and we've increased the price. So we want to see what was happening here. So instead of going for that 23,000, we said, how about if we go to 19,000 and change our selling price from 15 bucks to 16.50? Now, if the market will take it, okay, all of a sudden, they're selling a lot less, having to do less work, and they've got 52,500 on the bottom line instead of 33,500. So again, what's the market capacity in the businesses that you're looking for? How much will people take? Be very realistic with that. Can we go to the next one, Matt? So there, here we've got scenarios of sales volume change, price change, variable expense changes. So we move from $9 to $9.60, but we go and say fixed expenses changed. Instead of 70,000, we were able to cut some costs and we went to 60,000. Here's a game where drop sales volume, had the price adjusted, we're able to have to pay more for the product, 60 cents, and we got a 23% bottom line. So all four variables. So when you're thinking of a product that you're selling or a service that you're selling, think about those combinations. It's really, really important to know your volumes, to know what the market price is, to know how much you're paying for it, and can you get a better break? And then how can you manage those fixed costs that are necessary but often unnecessary? So for example, I could every day of the week get a phone call from somebody wanting to sell me something on marketing. Okay? And often I would have foolishly taken a shotgun approach where I should have been more focused. So for example, we're putting furnaces in houses. One marketplace that I'm not going to worry about is on the north side by the industrial park. Because when I did my analysis and looked at Stats Canada information, a lot of those fine folks had something called mechanical aptitude. I was looking for the teachers and the academics and the paper pushers. And at the time, they lived south of Henderson Lake. Okay? And that's when the west side wasn't developed a lot. That's where my focus was, because that was the folks that needed my service because they didn't know how to fix their own furnace. So where did I focus my material? Those folks. Now, I've been doing a lot of work for senior citizens lately, and I'm suggesting to you that there is a huge bubble moving over into the older ages there. Does your service fit some of their needs? Look at the markets. Are you into the millennials or the Gen Z? I believe is the next version that's coming out, you know? Or are you Gen X? Or are you a combination of them all? What are you looking for? Rona will tell you, in a declining market, it's renovations. In a growth market, it's new product. In a declining market, their good customers will spend 25% less than in a good market. That's the kind of analysis these guys have. Good stuff. So if you can hitch on to it, and how did we learn it? Through buying a case and reading about it and looking at their numbers. That was sort of quirky, but it was absolutely fascinating.
Well, I didn't have to buy the case.
Somebody did. Kept our costs down.
And like Bruce said, they're all interactive. Anything where he's putting in yellow in there, that's an interactive number. Go and take those sheets. If you don't understand numbers, and you don't understand numbers really, really well, go and play with these. Because you'll start to figure it all out. It'll all start to make sense. And if you can make sense of those numbers, you will be more successful down the road. 100% guaranteed you will be more successful.
So anything in yellow?
Anything in yellow here can be changed, yeah. And the green is the output to look for.
We didn't go and freeze all the other cells based on our time And but if you were a high-paying customer, we would have done that for you.
This one's right here.
So the last one, or second last one, markup versus margin. Okay, and I want to show you this particular graph, but I want to explain it first. In the contracting business, you buy something for $50 and you mark it up, and retail's the same. You mark it up and let's say you sell it for $100. Okay. The markup is 100%. Okay. Now, what banks look at is margin. So they say, okay, you're selling for 100, you paid 50 bucks, so you got $50 margin to help cover all the other costs you've got before you get to a bottom line. Okay. Now, when I got into the industry, guys hated to mark up things more than 10%. 25% they got to. But a lot of folks could not fathom marking things up. And then we'd give the example of jewelry stores. They mark things up big time, right? You know, I noticed it on some of my wife's purchases. Hey, what? For that, that's this big? You gotta be kidding me. Emotion, right? They play on people's emotions. If you want to see a really neat YouTube video, Warren Buffett on See's Candy. He owns See's Candy. And he's Warren Buffett, of course, he's one of the noted best investors in the world. He buys this little operation, See's Candy, is on the West Coast. And he'll do a little video showing you what his margins are. And he'll talk about how they, I was going to use the word prey on people's emotions, but candy at Valentine's and the huge marketing effort that happens that week before and the kind of bucks they make that take care of the rest of the year. Okay? So think about that. I have one client that works 8 weeks a year and makes over $1 million on the bottom line. And he just works hard 24/7 for 8 weeks a year and clears over $1 million. But he's got a niche. Hats off to him. My wife would never let me do that. Work 8 weeks, 24/7. She said, "You're a walking dead man. Goodbye." So you know what? So what I want to do is, tradesmen often call it markup. I'm saying change your language and call it margin. Bankers want to know what margin is involved in this particular. So this particular scale here, markup versus gross margin. A 200% markup, which sounds huge, only relates to a 66% margin. Okay. And then imagine us, we were down 15% markup, led us to a lousy 13% to try to pay things off. And in the sheet metal world, wastage on material is 13%. So just cutting out the metal and throwing metal away, and what we were doing was 13%. We basically were giving it away at cost. Crazy stuff. We also did one other stupid thing. We had something that looked like this. It's a scale. And we would build a product and put it on this scale and measure it for weight for material after the fact and never factored in how much scrap there was coming off of that. We gave it away. We were completely crazy. Okay? Crazy. And the Hutterite colonies came and took the scrap. They knew the value. And they worked with scrap, right? Pure genius. We got any more? Or are we gonna...
I think that's good. I got a really good margin and markup example, though. I had the pleasure on Sunday to sit in a salon management course. It was actually 2 days. It was Sunday and Monday because my wife is starting a salon, so I got to be the tag along for it. But I was sitting next to a woman who had owned her salon, I think, for 5 years or 6 years or something like that, up in Airdrie. And we were talking about retail product and how important it was because your margins are so much higher on this retail product. And she was talking about this, and she kept saying markup. Yeah, the manufacturer always tells me to mark it up 50%. Always 50%. That's right. I think you should be at 100%. I said, nope, they tell me 50%. So I said to her, do they tell you to mark it up, or do they tell you you want a 50% margin on it? Because that's that crossover there, right? 100%, 50%. So she's been in business for 5 years, And she's had the wrong price on her products because she couldn't figure out the markup versus the margin on it. So if you can get that, and it's a mistake that almost everybody that starts up in business makes. The people don't grasp that difference between markup and between margin. So if you can get that, you're a step ahead of everybody else. You have to understand that one.
Does that make sense, folks? The power of the numbers. Because I don't want you working one more hour than you have to. I want you to be able to make a return, right? Okay. Oh yeah, son of a gun. Yeah, we've got this cash cycle. The sooner you can collect your cash, the better off you are. A number of people said, hey, make sure you get the cash when the transaction takes place, like Starbucks and all those folks. And if you're in that kind of business, that's really, really cool. It doesn't exist for a lot of different people out there. This gives you an example with a manufacturer. You've got to buy that stock. You've got to make supplier payments. You've got to build whatever you're building. You've got to sell it. And then the customer is the debtor. They owe you. And you've got to have some cash. So I went into an organization in British Columbia, and I took a look at their transactions. And they had a transaction May 1st. And I said, OK, when does the customer receive it? And they don't send the bills out to the end of the May. But in fact, they really get their act together, and they get out in the middle of June. We did the analysis and found out that they get paid approximately July 28th because most of their customers say, those guys are so poor with their paperwork, we throw them into the wait pile. Okay? This particular person was a macho guy. He had the Harley, he had the big truck with the lifter kits, all in black and chrome, and he was literally in his office bawling his eyes out at an ugly guy like me. Because he couldn't make payroll. Because his cash was hung up. Okay? So I looked at his systems, and he had something called Simply Accounting. And Simply Accounting, you can automatically send the bill to your customers. So I was only there for half a day and said, why don't you do this? And he did it, and he shrunk his cycle of payments significantly, and he didn't have to beg for money anymore to make payroll. Seriously, simple things that allow you speed and flexibility on your pricing. So if we go up a little bit here, this one I did in black because I wanted to see what it looked like with these dirty filters. And the bottom line is, you buy inventory, pay for inventory, sell inventory, and get paid. I was so stupid when I was in the market of buying furnaces. And so here was the scenario for furnaces. Lennox, that a boy Dave, would come to me. Here's January, here's December. And that boy Dave, he arrived in February and said, boy, have we got a deal for you on furnaces. They're trying to unload what's in their manufacturing facilities. And we'll give you 90-day consignment, which means you don't have to pay for 90 days. I said, oh, goody, let's load up. So we got a whole bunch of furnaces, February, March, April 30th, we paid for them. I learned one thing. You don't sell furnaces all year round. You sell furnaces when the thermostat clicks in a house and they go and say, honey, there's no heat. Honey, maybe that metal box in the basement needs replacement, but I'd rather have granite countertops. Of the 250 things that people want, furnaces are the last. Found that out in research, and I'm in that business. Yeah, right? Okay. So the idea was, is look at this. I paid out, and I sat on these things for a long time. You'll install furnaces in October and November. You won't in December. Get out of my house. It's Christmas time. You won't in January. I got bills to pay. You won't in February because it's RSP season and tax season. And you won't in March because the thermostat's not clicking no more. Air conditioners in this market, if it's hot in May, you will sell air conditioners. Because they say, honey, it's already hot and I'm not putting up with this for another year. But if it's not hot in May, and it usually rains in June, okay, people go and say, well, we're away for 3 weeks in summer. Usually the first week of July and the first 2 weeks in August is when people are away, if you ask the Lethbridge Herald on circulation. Okay. They say, I can put up with it, honey. I'd rather have those granite countertops. Okay. Right. Okay. So I picked the lousy industry to be in. I look at the service guys that are in the service world here, they are dying. There is no work. Those furnaces haven't been wearing out. But AirTech, they got 17 service guys. Like, wow. I feel sorry for Dwayne Huber, who's the president of that company right now. You know, it's crazy. So they're all hoping for deals when it comes to incentives from the government on this whole efficiency, energy efficient thing. Every company's praying for that right now. That's their world. So they know their market. They're not having fun. Okay, so that's an example of where you can really get hung up on payment. This will send to you, but this is from Business Resource Services in Washington. They used to come up and do seminars for CIBC. But this is a little roadmap that says, if your net profit is low, what's caused it? Or gross margin, or low cash? And you go the opposite direction of the arrows. And that'll give you some ideas as to what might be some of your problems in your organization. So it's a real simple roadmap. I won't spend a lot of time on it, but if you're in financial distress, you can see that, hey, maybe you got too much inventory, maybe you got too much of receivables hanging out there, you maybe don't have proper pricing. There's a number of different components to look at. So it's a quick and dirty. We won't spend time on it today because that's a night in itself, but it was a very, very cool tool. Most of us have to go to university for 4 years to try to figure these dots out. Right? Here it is right in front of you. You don't need a degree. Maddie?
It took me longer than 4 years to go through university. Okay. Don't get overwhelmed, because what we're going to do is cut these numbers down in a second here. So how many people have been working on financial statements? About half? A little more than half? And that's part of what needs to be done?
That's a big part.
Okay. Okay, sounds good. So what we have here is a simplified income statement, a simplified balance sheet, and a simplified statement of cash flow. And again, it's big numbers right now. There's lots up on the screen. We're going to minimize it so it makes a little bit more sense. And we'll get it down so there's just a little bit less detail on the screen. This happens to be, I ran some numbers for a salon because, again, my wife starts up. That's all that's been on my mind the last 6 months, how she can bankrupt us. So.
Love. Love.
So this first portion up here is just going to be the income statement there. So the reason I liked the salon example was because there's service and retail component to it. So I'm sure lots of people in this room are putting together a business plan for services, lots are putting together for retail. So we have both components in there. And we also have some different variables that affect these components in different ways. So we have some of these input numbers that we can go and change around, and it'll skew some of the numbers in the income statement. But more importantly, we're going to get to see what that does to the balance sheet and the cash flow statement. So again, when we were talking before about you can make lots of money and have no money, right, you have no cash, we'll show you why that can happen in a business. So we have the revenue component up there, we have the service cost down here where we have what percentage we need to pay out. So in the salon world, it's about 60% that gets paid out in commission and benefits and all those really close direct costs. And on the retail side, we have the 50% margin, not a 33% margin, which would be a 50% markup, but a 50% margin there, which will leave over some gross margin there as well. And we have some expenses down at the bottom here, and finally we get earnings down here. So we put it at pretty even 11% throughout every month. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to condense some of these numbers. So we're going to get rid of 9 months, and then we'll get rid of some of the detail up top as well. So now this is our income statement here. Same statement, we've just simplified everything that's gone into it. So instead of looking at individual revenue, individual costs, we're just going to look at one revenue line, one cost line, which gives us our gross margin. We'll just leave the admin cost line, which is all those costs consolidated into one now, and we still end up with that same net income. So let's ignore this for just a second. We'll move down, and we have the balance sheet down here as well. So the important thing on the balance sheet is we just want to focus on the cash for now. Just focused on the cash. And then as well, we have a bit of a cash flow statement. Again, really, we're just trying to see what's going to happen with the cash here. So let's say that we have a pretty good month in January and February. And I've just set these numbers up so they're based on 100% being $30,000 in bill. So as we increase that 100%, we'll see a growth there. Okay, so we had a really, really good month now in January, had a really good month in February, and an average month in March. But the important thing to focus on isn't necessarily the earnings, because you can see, you know, our cost of sales are going to go up, the commissions are still getting paid out. Our gross margin is, of course, going to go up as we have more money that gets to be contributed towards those expenses. Our expenses really aren't changing because the majority of them are all going to be fixed in there. We don't have a ton of variable expenses outside of those commissions. So our earnings really do shoot up. We're at 11% margin before in the month, and now we jump up right up to $12,000 in net income. Everybody follow? But what's important to see here, so let me change this back. So we had a little bit of cash in the bank there. Started out $757, went up to $3,800, went up to $6,800. But all of a sudden we have these really good sales months and our cash goes. You can see at the end of January, all of a sudden, we have absolutely no cash left in the bank. We're short on that cash. So the question then is, what contributed to that in this, in the salon business? Because we know that most of our costs are gonna be in commissions. So that shouldn't affect it, right? We're getting more money in, we're paying some of the commissions out. But what happens is that typically in the salon world, your retail sales are tied in with what your service sales are. So the benchmark is 20%. You wanna have 20% of your sales, or 20% retail sales compared to what your service sales were. So it's called retail to service or something like that. It taught me for 2 days, but it wasn't all that technical. So what happens here, if we go and look a little bit more at the balance sheet, so as our retail sales increase, it means that we probably have to carry more inventory. And it also means that as that inventory sits on the shelves, that's the cash that you've paid out, right? You have to have something sitting there if you're gonna sell it to somebody. Most people aren't fortunate enough to be in a business where you can order your product on Tuesday and have it show up on Wednesday. It's just usually not how it happens. You're on a weekly or a bi-weekly type of an ordering basis. So if we know that we're gonna have those sales, it means that we have to increase the amount of inventory that's sitting on the shelves. So what I assumed is that we could turn 25% of the inventory that was sitting on the shelves. For different industries, that's going to be a different number. So in the food service industry, it's probably 95, 99% versus what you want before your shrinkage. And there's other industries out there. I worked in manufacturing and we tried to do only custom orders, but that certainly doesn't happen. So we might have a product that sits on our shelves, which is a warehouse, for 5 years. Because we built it to spec and nobody ever bought it. So we're assuming that we can turn things 25%. So that means that something comes in, sits on the shelf, the average product sits there for 4 months before it gets sold, or gets sold in that fourth month. So that is one of the things that's gonna drive up that, decrease your cash as your sales grow. So we're growing our retail sales, which means that we have to grow our inventory, which means that we're investing all of this cash into inventory that it's gonna take us a little while to recoup. But you see in March, when we come back down on sales, it means that we're able to lower our inventory back down and we start to get all that cash to come back. So look at the cash jump there. We go from negative cash to $4,000, to all of a sudden our sales drop way down in the month and we have $25,000 sitting in the bank. So that's what Bruce was saying on his graph. When he was busy, 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 and had no cash in it. The busier that he was, the less cash that he had. And it's the same thing when you deal in those in inventory. It's that the busier that you are in those inventory sales, typically the less cash that you're gonna have on hand. But it's also important to know that there's something that you can do to change that. We've assumed that we can turn our inventory one in every 4 months. right, that it will take us 4 months to sell that inventory. So we can turn 25% of our inventory over in any one given month. But if we really put an emphasis to focus on, let's push that faster, let's get, make sure that, first of all, it's getting out the door, but second of all, we have a really good system in place to know what we need on our shelves. So instead of ordering 12 bottles of shampoo in one particular product line, let's see if we can shorten it down to 4. And then we'll just have a shorter reorder point on. Maybe it means that we have a little bit increased cost because we have to pay extra shipping fees because we're having those smaller orders, maybe a little bit more frequent orders. But I'd rather pay a little bit higher when getting the product there more frequently and have cash in the bank than be sitting at negative $8,000 and be crying in the office trying to make payroll.
I had a manager, and I remember him to this day. He bought a dozen of something to sell one to a customer. And we counted that 11 units till I finally got so angry and said, throw that crap out. And we lost our fortune because he sold that one unit and it was a $10 item, you know. But we ended up having to buy 12 for that one cause. He didn't get it, you know. And every Christmas when I was counting inventory and everybody was out home enjoying life, I thought of him. Right, he rubbed me and probably caused a blockage.
So I don't think these graphs showed up all that well. This one won't work, but this graph here, yeah, I don't think they did turn out very well. Let's try this. So this graph here shows a fairly good representation of what we're talking about. So this is only focused on assets and cash, because really, in this kind of business, that's what's going to be the driver of your usage of your cash, is your inventory. If you're a high receivables world, where the majority of your sales are going through receivables, that's going to be a really high driver of cash usage or cash income as well. So your assets are going to be that inventory and the receivables.
Matt, why do you have accounts receivables?
Why do we?
Yes, in this example, in that kind of business, because I never get out of anywhere without giving them my debit card.
Yeah, typically in a salon, you're not going to, but you need another line item. We would never take something on account. Not to say that you shouldn't. There's lots of businesses out there where you need the receivables to generate those sales. But yeah, in a salon, we really wouldn't actually have those receivables. I don't care if my sister comes in and can't pay, she's paying.
Charge them more.
So you can see here, as the assets increase, we started about $22,000 and we have a little bit of cash in the bank. And then the assets jump way up because we're investing in all that inventory because all these sales are going on. We're saying, oh, we got to order. And sometimes what happens is people jump at it and they say, we just had a 20% spike. We got to stock up on inventory. So they'll go and double their inventory or triple their inventory because it's coming, everybody's coming. And then the sales decline next month, and now they have lingerie that's the wrong sizes because they've ordered just straight across the line. They haven't thought about what they're doing on their inventory. They haven't put the thought process in there. They jumped at whatever knowledge they had and said, let's just go do it, without doing that research on it.
The other component too, we had a person who was putting their plan together here. And from a tax purpose, they thought that if they bought all this inventory, that they could write it off and wouldn't have to pay tax on it. But inventory, you cannot have the advantage of writing off and not paying tax on it. It's only the inventory that you've sold goes against the revenue you sold. You're going to pay tax on your bottom line on your income statement, profit before tax. You can't use all your inventory as a tax deduction. It doesn't work that way. And seriously, one lady got herself into some significant problems thinking that all this inventory she had, she'd be able to write off, reduce her taxes, and wouldn't owe taxes. CRA are the last people you want to have a problem with. They seize bank accounts. We can relate, eh, Darlene?
Yep.
They seize bank accounts. You don't have control of anything once they're involved. Plus, you set a pattern and they come back and see you many times after that to see if you behaved. Don't make mistakes with CRA. Have you got a comment on write-offs? Remember, we talked about that phrase the other day.
Yeah, I'm a little bit passionate about what people say right after. I'm an accountant by trade. I'm definitely not a tax accountant, but I know enough about taxation to really drive me crazy when people talk about, oh, you could just write that off. You know what? I'll go out and buy it and you'll write it off, or I'll write it off in my business, not a big deal. Because I think a lot of times, well, I know a lot of times what people think is, it's okay, I'm gonna go out and buy this, the new cell phone, the business, because I'm getting it all back, I don't have to pay the tax, no worries on it. I'm gonna go out and I'm gonna put the vehicle, it'll be in the company's name, why not, it's a write-off, it's fine, I'm gonna get that cash. But you don't. Bruce talked about some of the smallest tax rates that are in the world, they're in Alberta here. What do we got, 13.5, I think?
Less for small business.
Less for small business. So you don't get that back. You get the savings in the tax portion back. So if you go out and you buy a $30,000 truck, it's probably $60,000. I have a little 03 Sonoma, so it costs me $8,000, and it's paid for.
Frugal. I like that. Yeah. Small business people need to be frugal.
But if you go out and buy that $30,000 truck, and it's a little bit different with vehicles, but really what you're getting back is, see, that 13%.
So what is that, 30? It's $4,000.
But let's just write it off. No, you're not writing off that. You're saving $4,000 in tax. Or people will say, we can write, let's go out, you have a big meal, let's just write it off. So we have a $600 meal, because it's business, that's fine, we'll get rid of it. Well, that's $600. The CRA comes in and says, well, you can't write all that off. So you can only write 50% of it off. So right away, you're down to $300. And then you don't get to claim all that GST back either. You only get to claim half that GST back, which then makes it an expense for you. So now GST on that would be 15.
No,
not very good at numbers on my computer. So $15. So now that costs you another $750. So now your write-off is actually $293.50.
On
13%. On 13%. So let's just write that off. Well, it's not a write-off.
Here's the kicker to me is, you gotta make money before you can have deductions, right? So if I'm taking somebody out for lunch, you get two slips. You get one that shows what the meal is, and you get one that's probably a MasterCard or a debit or something like that on it, okay? For CRA purposes, you need to keep both of them. I Googled meals, right? And one guy had put $10,000 claim in, it was denied $8,000 of it because he didn't have his slips. As simple as that. Plus on the slips, you better be writing who your customer is, okay? And what the purpose was on every one of them. Because you won't remember when they ask you 3 years later what that was all about.
You only get 50% of that anyway.
Yeah. Only if I'm making money can I even do this. That's the thing. People think I'm in business, I can write all this up. What's your sales revenue at to make it happen? And if you're not selling anything, what are you writing off? I need the cash to pay for the meal, right? And I don't have the cash because I don't have the business. That's the insanity of it all. And that's where people spend way too much money, not realizing I better be generating a lot of money in my salon in order to be able to take a client out and pay for these things. Be frugal. Don't buy all new. A banker would look at my place. We had 86 trucks at the time. He says, Bruce, I like some new, I like some used, and I like some old. Says, if I go in a place with all new, they don't know what they're doing. If I go to a place all old, they're spending too much money at their cabin in Whitefish. They're not reinvesting in their company. Okay? Think about it. Use things wisely.
Just on Bruce's point here, there is a fantastic app, and it is free, called Expensify. You can go on, you take a picture of your receipt, you can write in the comments exactly what, who the customer was, why you had that meal on. It's free. You put it into an expense report, so you can do it monthly or quarterly or however you want to expense it. And it's free. And it takes the picture. You take a picture of your receipt. Your receipt's gone because you have that now in your report. If CRA ever calls knocking, you can print it off and you have that. And I've asked, I called directly to CRA to see if they would accept that. And they said yes, they will accept the picture of it. So it's a really, really, really handy app when you have enough revenue to write something on that you can use.
So don't go on a party until you've earned.
Okay, so again, to just quickly jump back to this here. Again, as our inventory goes up, the cash goes down. But there's a few things that we can do about it. Let's focus on having a better ordering system in place. Let's make sure that we understand our customers a little bit more to know what kind of products they're gonna sell. Let's do some market research to know that in the month of December, you're gonna sell gift packs. And in most of the other months, you're not. Mother's Day comes around and you can sell some gift packs. But don't have gift packs sitting on your shelf in July or June, because Father's Day, they don't get gift packs from salons. It just doesn't happen. So we can put an emphasis on that and we can try to shift these numbers. So if we were turning it, if we were turning 25% of our inventory, well, I want to turn 75% of it. There's no reason we shouldn't be able to do that. Track what we're selling. Make sure that we're only selling products that are moving fast. I don't care. We don't need to have every product out there on our shelves. If it's not selling, it's gone. I don't care if somebody comes in and only wants that and leaves our salon because we don't carry it. I'm not gonna invest all of my cash into something that one person wants. So let's focus on this and say, we're gonna turn it 75%. That looks a lot better. Now all that cash that was tied up in inventory is now sitting in my pocket or sitting in my company's bank account. Now maybe I can go on one of those dinners or buy myself a truck because I have that cash there.
With a legit client.
Right.
With a legit.
Right.
Not your family.
No, never do that. So that's the power of it. And so many people don't focus, when they're in that retail world, they don't focus on inventory or any other type of business that you have receivables. You're not focusing on it. Like Bruce said, it goes from 104 days down to 28. In that kind of a world, that could mean an extra $1 million in the bank. I worked in manufacturing before. It's a big company. We, at one point, our receivables were up at 50, and we managed to get it down to 35. It made a huge difference. It was $800,000. $800,000 in cash that we had. Not for long, it did eventually, but I didn't have to keep calling the bank for more money. It wasn't that we weren't making money, we were making money. It was on the bottom line. It was all tied up in inventory, all tied up in receivables. You put a focus on that, and the cash will come. Right? Don't associate cash, though, with net income. You need your net income, and that's a really good measure for you, but that does not mean that you're gonna have cash. Make sure that you're focusing on things like inventory, accounts receivables. And then on the other side, focus on things like accounts payable. Right? The same thing on payables. You wanna collect in as few days as possible, and extend out payables as long as possible without pissing people off. So we would collect in 35 days and we try to pay out in 45 days. People are relatively happy. If you pay 45 days, you don't get too many angry phone calls, but you have that extra 10 days worth of cash sitting in your account. So you collect in 35, paid out in 45, tons of extra money. Run tight margins in manufacturing. So we had about 70% of our costs were direct, about half of that was product, actual material that went into it. So that could mean an extra $200,000 in the bank for us. So now we got $800,000 from receivables, we got $200,000 from payables, and now we have $1 million sitting in the bank. Does that make sense?
And again, it is sector specific because food services is 7 days. You better have a check form, right?
Yeah.
He's able to stretch it. And if you get insurance premiums, pay them when they're due. Don't stretch it because if they don't like you, they cancel the policy, right? So be very, very careful on some of these things you have contracts with.
Does that make sense on the cash, on what's going on there? So one final statement, and it's probably the least understood statement until I left university, I didn't really truly understand the cash flow statement, which is a little bit sad because it's probably the most important thing that you could ever know. Is the flow of your cash. But they don't teach it to people, right? right? You have to learn it out in the workforce, and you have to learn it by issues, right? You run into issues and you'll start to learn really fast. So know that cash, know where your cash is going, know where it's coming from. Make sure that you're tight on things like receivables, tight on things like inventory, and it'll all work out a lot better than if you don't know where those numbers are coming from. Do we have time for one really quick
one? Yeah, one quick one, yeah.
Okay. Just really quickly, we wanted to talk about your break-even analysis as well. So call it break-even or CVP, which is cost, volume,
profit.
Thank you. So your CVP, or your cost, volume, profit, essentially is just going to determine your break-even point in the business, or it'll help you determine that break-even point. So your break-even point is where you're making no money, but you're losing no money. So for a startup business, that's a milestone. To hit that break-even is a pretty big milestone. Like Bruce said, most businesses don't make money for the first year, year and a half. So when you can reach that break-even, and if you can do it in a couple months, perfect. Right? You know that you're on that trail of a successful business. But it is important to know what your break-even point is. So on your income statement, we have a bunch of different expenses on there, but we can classify some as fixed and some as variable. So your variable expenses in our salon would be the commission that we're going to pay to a stylist. We're not bringing revenue in, we're not paying anything out to them. There's some other variable.
Your shampoo product.
Oh yeah, the retail product that's coming in. So the cost of the actual items that are coming in, that's a variable expense. We don't sell it, we don't have to buy it except the inventory that's sitting on the shelves there. But we also have a lot of fixed expense in the business. I know that in our location over there, we have $50,000 with rent that we have to pay. We don't, just because we don't sell anything doesn't mean that we don't have to pay that.
Is that the beginning of the month they take it, or the end of the month from you?
They take ours at the beginning. Well, they bill us at the beginning. They bill us at the beginning. I won't tell you when we pay. They bill us at the beginning. So that's a fixed expense. We have our internet. As long as our shop is open, we have to pay internet. We have to pay utilities. Our utilities might go down if we're not running it. So there's some things that are a little bit, that can be variable and fixed, but we have those fixed expenses in there. So in this example, we have $77,000 of fixed costs. So what I want to do is break it down to the individual product market. So I've only used the service side just to simplify things. But I know that for $100 of service revenue, it's going to cost us $60. $60 in commission and direct benefits and things like that that get paid out. So that means that we have a contribution margin of $40 for every $100 that comes in. And our average ticket, we're assuming here, is going to be $100. That's when the women come in, not when the men come in. So it's really simple for us to figure it out. All I need to do is take what our fixed costs are and divide it by what this contribution margin is per ticket or per person that comes in. And I know that to cover off on those fixed expenses, we need to have 1,925 tickets in a year, or 1,925 people walk in the door at that average $100 rate. And that's really good to know, but I'm more of a let's break it down kind of guy. So I want to know, what does that mean in a week? Well, that means that we have 37 that we need in a week, and I know that we're open 68 hours in a week. So I know that I need 0.54 customers come in per hour. These are not our numbers, by the way. But 0.54 customers come in per hour for me to break even as a business. I know that if I get 0.55 come in, I'm going to start making money on that. If I'm at 0.53, I'm losing money on it. So it's a nice, simple way to figure out where you are on that threshold of making money and not making money. And then if we wanted just to convert it to dollars, we can just take those number services. We know that the average service ticket is $100, so we can convert that over. I know that our break even in dollars is $192,500 to cover off on those $77,000 of fixed costs. Make a little bit of sense? I know we've really blasted through that because I think we're already talking. We'll send out these spreadsheets anyway, so you can certainly go and play around with those numbers and let us know if you have any questions on them, because your financials are really, really, really important. It's really good if you understand the other areas of it, but you have to understand those financials as well.
So does that make sense, guys? I saw a thumbs up. Any other thumbs ups? Okay. So practical, small business, these multi-million dollar operations type thing, you know, trying to have the meat on the matter for you. The power of the numbers. Now you can see why some people do very well in business, because they've got those numbers figured and they're up in their head. They're not accountants, don't have to be. We've given you the basic calculations there, and that's where you can go from. Really, really important to know your market size, what you can charge in that marketplace, what it costs, and what the volume is you need to do. And when I looked at 1,932 customers, I go, whoa, I'd feel very uncomfortable. You know, and boy, that just would bother me. But I can't fathom how many people go through Starbucks every day. You know, like, you just sit there and you count the drive-thrus. And I look at Good Earth down the end, and I say, imagine if they had a drive-thru. What the volumes would be. I'd love to know, you know? Amazing. Yeah. Anyway, good stuff.
Perfect. Thank you.